Okay, so good morning to everyone. So let's start today's lecture. So before the test, right, we had just covered the pumping lemma for context-free languages. So just to revise this statement of the contrapositive of the CFL pumping lemma. So the CFL pumping lemma basically says that if you have a language, if you have a context-free language, then there exists a positive integer n, right, such that if you take any string z whose length is greater than or equal to n, I can always break down that string z into five different parts, right? So there exists some u, v, w, x, and y obeying some constraints, right? Such that two parts of this string, which is v and x, can be pumped in tandem, and the resulting string will still be n. So in order to, so we basically use, so this pumping lemma is a necessary condition for a language to be context-free. That's why we use it in its contrapositive form, prove that a language is not context-free. So where we say that if you're given a language L, right, then for every integer n, if I can always find a string z in L whose length is greater than or equal to n, such that no matter how I break down the string z, right, into five parts u, v, w, x, and y, obeying the constraints that the length of v, w, x is less than or equal to n, and both v and x are not empty. So length of vx is greater than 0, right? So no matter how I break down the string z, right, in this form, obeying these constraints, I can always find an integer I such that u v to the power I w x to the power I y is not in L. So I can always find an I such that if I pump v and x in tandem by I, the resulting string will not be in L. Right? So if this is true for language L, then the language L is not a CFL. Right? And we can sort of represent or write down this contrapositive in the form of a game, right? Whereby all the universal quantifiers are basically picked by the daemon, and the existential quantifiers are picked by the player. And basically, the player has a winning strategy only if you have a winning strategy, the player has a winning strategy, then the language L is not a CFL. Right? So we saw a couple of examples of how to apply this game, right? So in particular for this language 0i10i10, right? So where we are matching three counts of zeros, we proved that this particular language is not a CFL. And we also applied it on this example, right, which is this AIBJCK, where I is less than or equal to J is less than or equal to K. And we showed that this language is also not a CFL, right, by picking the string A and B and C N. So applying the pumping lemma, it basically requires you to pick a string Z, right? Pick the string Z in a clever manner, such that you can use the constraints, the length of VWX is less than or equal to N, and V and X are both not empty together, right, in order to generate strings which won't be the language, right? So we saw that in different cases, you may have to pick different values of the pumping factor I as well, right? So there is a third example, which is that to prove that the language of the form WW, where W belongs to 0, 1 start, is also not a CFL, right? So I'm not going to cover this, right? So I'll leave this as a reading exercise, right? So the entire example is there in the slides. So please take a look at it, right? And follow it on your own. Right? So today I'm going to begin the next topic in context-free languages. And my goal is to finish context-free languages today itself, right? So that since we have a couple of holidays which are coming up, I want to begin the next topic, which is Turing machines, right, from Thursday. So, let's look at properties of context-free languages, right? So far, right, for this class of context-free languages, we have seen two representations, context-free grammars and, so we have seen two representations, context-free grammars and pushdown automata. Right? We saw that both of these representations are actually equivalent to each other, right? We have seen some properties of grammars, right? So for example, we have seen parse trees, we have seen whether or not a grammar is ambiguous or not. Right, and we have seen normal forms of grammars, which is the Chomsky normal form. And finally, in the last lecture, we also saw how to prove that a language is not context-free, right, by through the pumping lemma. Okay. So here, so in today's lecture, we are going to look at properties of context-free languages, right? Which are decision properties and closure properties, right? So we did the same exercise for regular languages. So decision properties are basically properties about the entire class of a language, right? So in the sense that if you're given a language, right, we want an algorithm which would through which we can say something about the language, right? So can we say that the language is empty, can we say the language is infinite, and so on, right? While closure properties basically talk about performing operations on languages. So if you perform, say, union, intersection, or complement, or anything, right, so is the class of context-free languages closed under these properties, right? So if you take the union of two CFLs, do you get a CFL, and so on, right? So let's first summarize. Let's first look at the decision properties of CFLs. So let's summarize these properties. So as usual, right, when we talk about a CFL, right, we really mean a representation of the CFL. So when I say that I want an algorithm, right, which takes as input a CFL and says something about the CFL, right, then what I really mean, right, is that the algorithm is going to take as input either a grammar or a PDA, right, which accepts by either final state or empty stack. And then from this grammar or the PDA, it's going to say something about the language of the grammar of the PDA. So in the case of CFLs, there are algorithms to decide if a string W is in the CFLL, whether or not a CFLL is empty, and whether or not a CFLL is infinite. Right. So in today's lecture, I'm only going to cover the first one. Right. And so the second and the third are actually very straightforward. And I'll again leave this as a reading exercise. So before we talk about a decision property, right, we should also talk about non-decision properties. Right? So this is where the class of CFLs differs from the class of regular languages. Right? So in the sense that there are some questions about a CFL that you cannot answer. Right? So in the sense that there is no algorithm which can decide whether or not a CFL has that property. So many questions that can be decided for regular sets cannot be decided for CFLs. Which means there is no decision procedure, right? There is no algorithm which can do that, right? So here are a couple of examples, right? So are two CFLs the same, right? Or are two CFLs disjoint? Okay. So let's say that you're given two context-free languages, right? You can be either given two grammars, right? Or you can be given two PDAs. Okay. Yeah, I'm sorry, I lost the connection there. Yeah, so as I said, right, so we are given two CFLs and we want to find out whether or not they are the same, right? Which means that are the two sets of strings same, right? Or we could ask the question that if you're given two CFLs, whether or not they're disjoint, which means that is there a common string among the two CFLs. So as it turns out, right, both of these properties cannot be decided for a CFL. In the sense that there is no algorithm which would take as input two CFLs, right, two representations of CFLs, and actually answer, right, whether or not. So it can take as input any two CFLs, right, and would answer whether or not the CFLs are the same or the CFLs are disjoint. But on the other hand, this is possible for regular languages. So for regular languages, there is an algorithm, right, which would take as input two regular languages and which would answer, right, whether or not the regular languages are same or they're disjointed. So again, regular languages can also be infinite, right? So you take as input two finite representations of regular languages, right? So we could take, for example, a DFA, right, or a regular expression, right? And there is an algorithm which would decide whether or not the regular languages corresponding to the languages corresponding to those representations are the same or they're disjoint. Right? So in the sense that, so there will be two different algorithms, right? So the one algorithm would decide whether or not they are same. The other algorithm would decide whether or not they are disjoint. So any suggestions for how we can do this for a regular language? What would be an algorithm? So let's look at the first question, right? Which is that, are two regular languages the same? So how would you decide? Let's say you're given two DFAs. How would you decide whether or not the two DFAs accept the same language? Okay, yeah, so I'm not getting any response. The answer is that, okay, yeah, Sriram Gautam is saying product automaton. That's very good, right? So that's correct, right? So you can actually construct the product automaton, right? So if you're given two DFAs, you construct the product automaton, right? And then how would you answer the question that the language are the same? Sanchit is asking general Mihail-Narod relations as well for both. Okay. Yes, maybe you could do that as well, right? So I am assuming that you would then check the equivalence classes or anything, right? Because how would you actually determine whether or not two relations are same? So an easy way to do this, right? Okay, so both will be same except naming. So maybe I think you meant that you would actually generate the minimal automaton for the two. Yeah, exactly. So we can reduce to the shortest DFA. Yeah. So that's another way to do it, right? So, but yeah, as I said, a simple way to do it would be to just construct the product automaton, right, of the two DFAs. And then if you want to answer whether or not the two languages are the same, the final state of this product DFA would be what? What should be the final state of this product automaton? If I want to answer the question that the two CFLs or the two regular languages are the same. So I can take the final states of the product automaton to be the product of the final state of one automaton and the non-final states of the other. Union the non-final states of the first and the final states of the other, right? And then I can ask whether or not the resulting DFA is empty or not. Right? The language is empty or not. So if the language is non-empty, right, then this means that there exists a string which takes one of the DFAs to a final state and other to a non-final state, right? Which means that it's there in one of the languages and not there in other, right? Hence they are not the same. But then if the language is empty, then I can definitely say that the two regular languages are the same. And similarly, you can do this for disjoint as well. So Vinith is asking, how can we check for isomorphism, right? So in fact, that's the thing that we are actually looking for, right? So in the sense that if you even convert them to shortest DFAs, then you then get two DFAs and you have to answer the question, right, that whether or not they accept the same language. So but you can construct a product automaton for that, right? And similarly for in the case of disjoint languages as well, you can construct a product automaton. But so you can't do this for CFLs, right? So in the sense that there is no algorithm which can decide whether or not two CFLs are the same, right? So in order to prove this, we actually need the theory of Turing machines, right, and decidability. So this is the topic that we'll cover next, right, after this one, to show that this is actually a non-decision property. Okay, so let's look at something that we can actually answer, which is testing membership, right? So if we are given a CFL, right, let's say L, and we are given a word W, and this membership question basically asks that is the word W in the CFL L or not? Okay. So if you want, so we want to know whether or not a string W is in the language, right? Is in the CFL. Right? So if, let's say, if you are given the CFL in the form of a grammar G, right? So we are given its context-free grammar, and we want to find out whether or not this string is in the language of G. So there are some brute force ways in which you can do this, right? So for example, right? So if I'm given the string w, right, so I know its length. So let's say that its length is n. Then I can basically generate all parse trees, right? Whose yield will be of length n. Right? So I can do this, right? So I can basically enumerate all the parse trees, right? Beginning from the smallest parse tree, right? And then once I generate all strings of length n, I can find out whether or not w is there. But this procedure is going to be exponential, right? Clearly, in n. Similarly, if I am given a PDA, right, for example, then I can sort of remember that this could be non-deterministic. So if the pushdown automaton is non-deterministic, then I can simulate a non-deterministic pushdown automaton. Right? So whereby at every step I will have choices, right? So I can explore all the choices. So I can basically run the word, the string w on the pushdown automaton. But since it is non-deterministic, at every step I'm going to have multiple choices. I would explore all the possible choices, right? And eventually, if there is a choice which leads me to either a final state or an empty stack, depending upon the acceptance criterion of the PDA, I will accept the string. But again, this procedure is also going to be exponential in n, right? Because at every step in n, I will have multiple choices, right? So instead, we have a clever algorithm, right? Whose running time, right, is polynomial in n. In fact, it's n cube, and this algorithm can decide whether or not a string is in a CFL. So this algorithm is called the CYK algorithm, right? And so this algorithm assumes that the grammar is in Chomsky normal form. Right? So if it is not in Chomsky normal form, then we first have to convert the grammar to CNF. But we know that we can do this, right? So there is an algorithm, right, which can convert any given grammar to CNF. And remember that when we convert the grammar in CNF, right, we remove epsilon, right? Since that if epsilon is there in the language of the grammar, it won't be there. If epsilon is there in the language of the original grammar, it won't be there in the language of the grammar after it's converted to CNF form, right? But I can easily check, right, whether or not epsilon is present in the language of the grammar, basically by doing this nullable analysis, right? So we have already seen, right, that how we can do this nullable analysis, right? So whether or not a string, whether or not a symbol can generate epsilon, right? And we can find out whether or not the start symbol can also generate epsilon in the original grammar. And in that way, we can find out whether or not epsilon is in the language of the grammar. So this CYK algorithm is for all strings which are other than epsilon, right? And so we first convert the grammar to CNF and then we start the algorithm. So the CYK algorithm is a good example of dynamic programming. So it uses this concept of dynamic programming, which you must have studied, right, in your PDS course. And this algorithm runs in order of time, which is n cube, right? So where n is the length of w. So it's polynomial in the size of the string. So it's named after three people, J. Kok, T. Younger, and T. Kasami, who independently discovered the same idea, right? So let's look at the CYK algorithm. So let's assume that this string w is whose length is n is of the form a1 dot 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 up to an. So what the CYK algorithm does, right, is that it constructs this n by n triangular array of sets of non-terminals. So given the grammar g, right, it will have some set of non-terminals, right? And for a string of length n, we will construct an n by n matrix, right? Triangular array. So in fact, we will only consider the lower half of the matrix. That's why it's a triangular array, where each member, right, of this matrix or this array, this triangular array, is going to be a set of non-terminals from the grammar. And so what will be the set of non-terminals, right? So for every I and j, right, where this I and j, right, is basically the ith entry, right? So I'm going to construct this particular matrix, right? And if I take xij, right? So this will be xij. And this xij will be set of non-terminals. In fact, it will be exactly those non-terminals which can derive the substring of w from I to j. So if A can derive AI to AJ, then this particular non-terminal A is going to be present in Xij, right? And we are going to fill this X is right in the entire lower half of this matrix, right? So ultimately, right, we will also fill X1 in, right? And if the start non-terminal S is present in X1 in, then the string, right, can be derived from the start symbol, which means it is there in the language of the CFL. If S is not there in X1 in, then you can't derive it. So yeah, so finally we ask whether or not S, which is the start non-terminal, is there in X1 in. So we are going to construct this particular matrix, right, in a step-by-step fashion, right, ultimately leading to X1 in. So let's see how we are going to fill up this matrix, right? So first we will fill up all the diagonal entries in this matrix. So which means all the entries of the form xii, right? So this xii is simply will basically be the set of all non-terminals which can derive the string ai, right? Where ai is basically the ith symbol, right, in the word w. So a single symbol, right? So remember that this is so we are talking about a grammar which is in Chomsky normal form. So it's in CNF, right? So which means that only productions of the form A generates AI, right, can basically generate a single string, rather a string of length one, right? So only if A, so this XII is going to consist of all the non-terminals A, such that A generates AI is a production, right, in the grammar. So if A generates AI is a production rule in the grammar, then we are going to add the non-terminal A to XII, right? And XII in fact is going to consist of all of these non-terminals, right? So once we have filled the diagonal entry, right, so then so we have filled all the entries in the diagonal, and then we are going to fill the remaining entries, right? So we are going to use whatever is there in the matrix, right, in order to fill the remaining entries. So in particular, right, so if you want to fill say Xij, then this is going to consist of all the non-terminals A, right, such that so first let's look at the definition, right, and then we'll explain, right? So there is a production of the form A generates BC and an integer K, right, with K being greater than or equal to I and less than J, such that B is in Xik and C is in Xk plus 1 comma J. So basically I want to find out all the non-terminals that can generate the string A, that can generate the string Aij, right? So from Ai to Aj. So I will basically try to look at different ways in which I can generate the string, right? Since the grammar is in Chomsky normal form, right? Ultimately, right, you would have basically generated so you basically break the string somewhere here, right? And let's say some ak, right, and you would have generated first ai to ak, right, and then ak plus 1 to aj, right? So which means that you basically need to look at so let's say if b can derive ai to ak, right, and c can derive ak plus 1 to aj, right, if there is a production rule of the form a generates bc, then a can derive ai to aj. Right. And in fact, this is the only way in which I can derive the string ei to ag, right? Because the grammar is in Chomsky normal form, right? So that's why there must be some way of breaking this string ei to aj into two parts, right? And the resulting I look at the terminals which would have generated the two parts, right? I'll basically look at the non-terminals which would have generated the two parts. And I consider all possibilities there, right? So I can look up the matrix itself now, right? Because this k, right? So I'm looking at strings of length which are less than in this case j minus I plus 1, right? So I would have already calculated the corresponding non-terminals, right, which would have derived the smaller strings, right? So I can simply look up the matrix, right, in order to fill the remaining entries. So this is the explanation, right, for the algorithm, right? So we will first demonstrate this algorithm on a simple example, and then and then we'll look at the actual algorithm itself. So are there any questions so far regarding the algorithm? Okay, so let's look at this example. So let's consider this grammar. So this grammar has three non-terminals, rather four non-terminals, which is S, A, B, and C. And the terminals are small a and small b. And let's say if you want to find out whether or not the string W is equal to A B A B A is in the language of the grammar. And so note that the grammar is in Chomsky normal form. So every production rule, if you look at its body, right? So it's either a single non-terminal, or it is, or rather it's either a single terminal, right? Or it is two non-terminals. So that's why it's in Chomsky normal form. Right? So if you want to find out whether or not this string is in the language of the grammar, so the length of this string is phi. Right? Which means we will construct a 5x5 matrix. And we will only fill the lower half of this matrix, right? So here is the 5x5 matrix, right? And so we'll only fill the lower half of this matrix, right? So the first step that we do is that we fill all the diagonal entries. So in order to fill the diagonal entries, we will actually look at the string, right? So for example, right, the first let's look at the first element, right? Or the first symbol in the string, right, which is the small a. Right. So there are two non-terminals which can generate small a, right, which are A and C. So that's why I will basically put AC, right, at position one. Similarly, A is there in the third position as well. So I'll put AC there also. And I'll put AC there. And then, so there are two non-terminals which can generate B, right, which is B and C. So I'll put BC here. So in the first step, I'll basically fill all the diagonal entries, right? And in order to fill the diagonal entries, I will consult the string, right? So in order to fill the diagonal entry II, right, I'll basically look at WI, right, which is the ith position in the string. And I'll look at all the non-terminals in the production rules, which can generate that particular symbol. Okay? So I have filled out all the diagonal entries, okay? So now, once I have filled out all the diagonal entries, I can basically forget about the string itself, right? And then I will basically fill out the remaining entries in the matrix using the entries that are already present. Right? So, for example, right, let's say I want to fill this particular element, right? Which is, let's say I want to fill 1, 2. Right? So this is going to be the string which can, or rather the non-terminals which can generate the string AB. Okay. So there is only one way to break this string, right? So I look at 1, 1, and I look at 2, 2. Right? So I look at the entries in position 1, 1 and position 2, 2. Right? So there are four combinations here, right? So for example, I can look at AB, right? I can see that S can generate AB, so that's why S is going to be present. And then I can also consider AC, right? And B can generate AC, so that's why B will be present. And that's all, right? So the other combinations that I get is CB and CC, but they are not there in the body of any production rule, right? So that's why I will get only S and B, right? So similarly, you can in this way, right, you can basically fill up all the entries which are in this position, right? So which are basically below the diagonal, right? So for example, for 2, 3, I would look at 2, 2 and 3, 3. And for 3, 4, right, I can look at 3, 3 and 4, 4, and for 4, 4, I can look at, for 4, 5, I can look at 4, 4 and 5, 5. Right? So in this way, I can fill up this particular entries, and I'll get this. So 1, 2, I'll get SB. At 2, 3, I'll get A. At 3, 4, I'll get SB, and at 4, 5, I'll get A. Okay. So now I will fill up the entries that are below this diagonal. So let's look at 1, 3 now, right? So I want to fill up the position 1, 3. Right? So now there are two ways in which I can break 1, 3. Right? So I can look at I want to basically break down this string, right? So which is this ABA string. right? So there are two ways in which I can break this, right? So I can either do 1-1 and 2-3, or I can do 1-2 and 3-3, right? So I will look at the corresponding entries there, right? So 1-1 is here and 2-3 is here, right? So I get AA and CA, but none of those are useful because they are not the they are not in the body of any production rule. So next I will look at 1-2 and 3-3. So 1-2 is here and 3-3 is here. So here I'm going to get BC, and A generates BC. So that's why A is going to be present here. And similarly, you can fill up the other two as well, right? So for example, for 2-4, right, I will look at 2-2 and 3-4, and then I will look at 2-3 and 4-4, right? And you can fill up the remaining entries as well. So you're going to get A, S, B, and A, right? And then I'll fill up this diagonal, and then finally this one, right? So for filling up this diagonal, so now there are three ways in which I can break 1-4, right? So I can look at 1-1 and then 2-4, right? Which is here, right? So this is 1-1 and 2-4, right? Or I can look at 1-2 and then 3-4, which is here. Or I can look at 1-3 and then 4-4, which is here. So I need to consider all these three combinations and see whether or not any of the resulting non-terminus that I get, right, whether or not they are present in that same order in the bodies of the production rules, right? So I'll get S, B, and A here, and finally for the last entry, which is 1-5, I'm going to get A, right? So this means that the entire string W, right, can only be generated or can only be derived from the non-terminal A. So it cannot be derived from S, and therefore this particular string is not there in the language of this grammar, right? On the other hand, if S were to be present in 1-5, then it is present, right? Then S can derive the particular string, and therefore the string would be there in the language of the grammar. So that's how the algorithm works. So let's look at the pseudocode of this algorithm, right? So this is just for clarification, right? So this is just basically saying writing in code, right, whatever it is that we did in the last few slides, right? So first, right, so this for loop fills out all the diagonal entries, right? So for all I equal to 1 to n, right, it fills out entries of the form xii by basically looking at production rules of the form the terminal production rules, right, of the form A generates A, right? And then this particular loop for loop, right, so this is a nested for loop, right? So there are three for loops here, right? And so this will basically look at strings of higher length, right? Substrings of higher length. So M is the length of the substring that you're looking at. So M goes from 2 to N, right? And then the next nested for loop is basically going to look at the start position, right? Which is I, right? Which can go from 1 to N minus M plus 1. And finally, the last for loop, the third nested for loop, is going to look at ways of breaking down this particular substring, right? So look at k equal to I to j minus 1, okay? So after this algorithm is complete, right, all the entries in the lower half of the matrix will be filled, and you then look at x1n, right, and find out whether or not s is present in x1n or not. So this is algorithm, right? You can do the complexity analysis of this algorithm, right? So you'll find that there is this nested for loop, right? So there are three nested for loops, and all of them can run up to length n, right? And we are also checking this for all production rules, right? So if n is the length of the word, and p is the number of production rules, right? So n is the length of the word, and p is the number of production rules, and the complexity is going to be order of n cube p. Right? So this is in fact the fastest known algorithm, right, in order to check whether or not a string is there in the language of the whether or not a string is present in this in a CFL, right? So what about a regular language, right? So what's the complexity of checking whether or not a string is present in a regular language? Just to compare this right, with this complexity. So remember that if I'm given a regular language, right? Okay, so Vinith is saying n square, right? So I can have any representation of the regular language, right? So let's say that, for example, I'm given, so I can convert any representation. So if I'm given a DFA, for example, so is it really n square or is it less than that, right? Think about it. Yeah, Kostab is saying order of n. So that's correct, right? So in fact, it is exactly n, right? So you can just run the DFA, right? So this is a deterministic machine, right? And since it is a DFA, right, it's basically going to take exactly n steps, right? So if n is the length of the word, then in n steps, right, you will either be in a final state or a non-final state, right? And depending upon where you are, you can basically either accept or reject the string, right? So that's why its complexity is order of n. So you can see that as we have increased the complexity of the language, right? So we know that CFLs are the class of CFL, right, is much bigger than the class of regular languages, right? So we have also increased this complexity of checking whether or not a string is in the language, right? So remember, that is how we actually motivated, right, that why we are looking at languages, right? Because ultimately, right, we want to know, right? So we want algorithms for finding out whether or not a string is in a language, right? Because any problem, right, can basically be reduced to a membership problem, right? And as we increase the complexity, right, of the problem, right, in fact, the time complexity also increases. Right? Okay. So in the rest of the lecture, let's try to cover as many closure properties as I can, right? And whatever I don't cover, I'm going to leave as reading exercise. So as usual for closure properties, right? So we are looking at performing these operations, right, on CFLs, right, and finding out whether or not the resulting language that you get is still a CFL or not. Right? So it's known that CFLs are closed under union, concatenation, and cleanly closure. So this is the asterate operator. So which means that if you are given two CFLs, right, and if you take their union, the resulting language is also a CFL. Similarly, if you take two CFLs and if you concatenate them together, right, then the resulting language is still a CFL. And if you take a CFL and you take its asterate, right, then the resulting language is also a CFL. And CFLs are also closed under other operations, right? Such as reversal homomorphism and inverse homomorphism. Right? So in fact, this reversal was one of the questions in the problem set, right? And closure properties are also, and CFLs are also closed under homomorphism and inverse homomorphisms. However, a key point of difference, right, between CFL and regular languages, another key point of difference is that CFLs are not closed under intersection or difference. Unlike regular languages, right, which are actually closed under intersection or difference, right? So which means that if you're given two CFLs, right, and if you take their intersection, the resulting language may not be a CFL. So let's first look at this non-closure, right, under intersection. So unlike the regular languages, the class of CFLs is not closed under intersection. So in order to, so we can easily demonstrate this, right? So for example, so we can use a language which we know is not a CFL. So for example, this language 0n, 1n, 2n, equal number of zeros, ones and twos. This language is not a CFL, right? So in fact, we actually did cover this particular language, right? This EI, BJ, CK, right? Where I is less than or equal to J is less than or equal to K. Right? But we didn't cover this exact example, but you can easily sort of show this using the pumping lemma, right? That the 0n, 1n, 2n is not a CFL. Okay. However, there are two languages that I can construct which are both CFLs and whose intersection is going to be this language, right? So I'm going to, so I'm, so I'm, so I'm, so I'm, So what I'm going to do, right, is that I'm going to give two languages, let's say L2 and L3, which are both CFLs, and their intersection is going to be L1. Okay. So can anyone suggest what those languages are going to be? Yes, so Vinith is saying 0i, 1j, and 2k. Okay, so this is just one language. Okay, 0, 1, 2 star with equal of all. Okay, so I'm not sure if that is actually a CFL. 0, so Kaustav is saying 0i, 1i, 2j, and 0j, 1i, 2i. Okay, so let me write that down. So 0i, 1i, and 2j, and then 0j. 1i and 2i. Okay, so this is the language where you have equal number of zeros and ones, but I can have any number of twos, and this is the language where I have equal number of ones and twos, but I can have any number of zeros. Okay, and Samuel Moses is suggesting another language, AIBJCK, where IJK non-increasing and non-decreasing. BJCK and IJK are non-decreasing. But why would that be a CFL? So, in fact, I thought we showed that this language of this form, right, is not actually a CFL. So, I'm not sure if that's actually going to be a CFL. So, let's look at this this suggestion. Yeah. So, let's look at this suggestion by Kaustav, right? So in fact, both of these are CFLs, right? So I can generate either a grammar, right? Or I can give a PDA for these two languages, and therefore they are CFLs. But if I take their intersection, right? Then in their intersection, right? So what's going to happen, right? So if I take a string that's there in both of these languages, then it's going to have equal number of zeros, ones, and twos, right? Because if it is there in the first language, right, then the number of zeros is going to be equal to the number of ones, and if it is also there in the second language, then the number of ones is going to be equal to the number of twos, which means that the number of is also going to be the same as the number of zeros. So yeah, so that's correct, right? So yeah, so this 0n, 1n, 2i, and similarly this 0i, 1n, 2n. They are both CFLs, and their intersection is, in fact, the 0 and 1 and 2. And so this basically demonstrates that CFLs are not closed under intersection. Right. So let's look also look at non-closure under difference. Okay. So here we are trying to show that CFLs are not closed under difference, right? Which means that if you take two CFLs, right? So let's say L and M. And if you take that difference, then the resulting language need not be a CFL. So in fact, we can prove something much more general, right? Which is that any class of languages that is closed under difference is also closed under intersection. Which means that, so let's say that the class of CFLs or any class of languages were to be closed under difference, okay? Then it would also be closed under intersection. But since we know that, for example, CFLs are not closed under intersection, this would imply that they are not closed under difference as well. So how can we show, right, that any class of languages that is closed under difference is also closed under intersection? So we know that the languages are closed under difference, right? which means that if I take difference of any two languages in the class, I will get another language in the same class. Right? So can I express intersection in the form of difference? Okay, so intersection is, okay, so I'm assuming that this is A intersection B, which is written as A union B, and then difference. So I'm not sure about this, right? So what is this A plus B? Remember that I only know that the class of languages is closed under difference, right? So it may not be closed under union as well. So how can I express intersection just using difference? Right, that's the question. So let's actually draw a Venn diagram here, right? So let's say that this is A and this is B, right? So I want to express this, right, which is this A intersection B, just in the form of a difference. Okay, yeah, that's correct, right? So Vinith is saying A minus B, right? So that is correct, right? So I can take A and then I can subtract A minus B from it, right? So I can, so A minus B, right, is going to be this thing. And if I actually take the difference of A minus B from A, I'm going to get A intersection B. So this means that if the class of languages were to be closed under difference, right, then it would also be closed under intersection, right? Because then A minus B is going to be so if A and B let's say are in the class, are in that class, right, then A minus B is also going to be in that class, and therefore A minus B is also going to be in the same class. But this is the same as A intersection B, and that would mean that the intersection is also in the same class, right? But since we know that in the case of CFLs, right, they are not closed under intersection, and therefore they won't be closed under difference as well. Okay. So if CFLs were closed under difference, then they would be also closed under intersection, which they are not, right? And therefore they are not closed under difference as well. Okay. So that's the end of the non-closure properties, right? So now let's try to look at some of the operations under which CFLs are in fact closed, right? So they're closed under union, right, for example. And so this can be very easily shown, right? So if you're given grammars of two CFLs, right? So if you're given context-free grammars, so let's say L and M are CFLs, and you're given their grammars G and H, right? Then you basically just need to add one more production rule, right? So let's say that for example, right, suppose SG, right, was the start symbol of the grammar G, right, and SH was the start symbol of grammar H, right, then I just need to add this new production rule, right? S generates SG or SH, where S is a new non-terminal, right, and the rest of the production rules, right, from G and H will be present in the new grammar as well, right? So I basically generated a CFG, right, for L union M, right, by basically taking a union, right, of the production rules of the two individual grammars. So of course for this you have to assume that the grammars have no non-terminals, right, or variables in common, but we can easily ensure that, right? Yeah. So we add the new production rule of the form S generates S1 or S2. Okay. So similarly, you can also do the same thing for concatenation, right? So I can add the production rule S generates S1, S2, right? And this new grammar is going to then generate all strings in which will be concatenation of the strings of the two languages. And similarly for asterisk, right, I can add a new rule of the form S generates S1, S or epsilon, right? So where S is the start symbol of the original grammar, right? So So if you take the line, if you take the original CFLL, right, and its grammar G with its start symbol S, rather S1, right, is the start symbol of the original grammar, then I create a new grammar for the asterisk by considering, right, by basically simply copying all the production rules of the original grammar and then adding this one new production rule. So here I can, so this production rule basically generates as many copies of S1 as I want, right? And then for all of those copies, right, I can generate strings of the language itself. So similarly, the CFLs are also closed under homomorphism. Right? So homomorphism, remember, is basically a function, right, from an alphabet sigma, right, to another alphabet sigma prime star, right. So for every symbol in sigma, it associates a string in this alphabet sigma prime, right. H of L, right. So if you are given a language L, H of L is simply H applied to every string W in the language. So if we are, so if I'm given, let's say, a CFLL, right, which means I'm given, for example, a context-free grammar for L, I can automatically construct a context-free grammar for H of L. And I can do this by simply replacing every terminal symbol A by H of A in the production rules. Right? So here's an example, right, for that. So for example, if I'm given the grammar S, generates 0s1 or 0 1, right? So this is the 0 and 1 in the language, and suppose I'm giving this homomorphism that h of 0 goes to ab and h of 1 is equal to epsilon, then h of lg, right, which is basically the homomorphism applied to the language of this original grammar, so this is also going to be a context-free language, and its grammar is basically going to be this grammar where every string, right, is replaced by its homomorphism, right? So zero, every symbol is replaced by homomorphism. Similarly, CFLs are also closed under inverse homomorphism as well. So this inverse homomorphism H inverse of L is basically the set of all strings W belongs to sigma star such that H of W belongs to L, right? So here grammars won't help us, right? So there is a construction which takes a PDA of L, right, and then automatically constructs a PDA for H inverse of L, right? So I'm not going to cover this construction, right? So it's very straightforward, right? I'm going to leave this again as a reading exercise, right? So you can take a look at it on your own, right? And similarly, so even though CFLs are not closed under intersection, they are closed under intersection with a regular language. So which means that if you take a context-free language and a regular language, right, and take their intersection, then the resulting language is always going to be a CFL, right? We can show this as well by basically looking at the DFA of the regular language, the PDA of the CFL, and running both of them in parallel, right? And if you look at the combination is still going to be a PDA, right? Which means that the resulting language is still a CFL. So this is very similar to the product construction that we add for DFAs, right? Except here we're taking the product of a DFA and a PDA, right? And noting that the combination is still a PDA, okay? So again, you can take a look at it, right? So the details are there in the slides, again, I'm not going to cover this in class, okay? So this basically ends the section on context-free languages, right? And beginning from the next lecture, I will look at the next topic, which is Turing machines and decidability. So thank you everyone, and that's the end of today's lecture.